then we'll take it line by line by understanding how it is.
The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, now I'm opening this to questions, and I would request people to answer. If today in the afternoon I was saying, Lord, I mean everyone knows this psalm, but what do I teach you on this psalm, and how do I understand something? And the Lord just took me to a situation and asked me one question: have you ever been lost in life? And I want to open this with a question: have any one of you been lost in life physically? Okay. First, let's deal with the physical one. If you ever got lost, you know, you've taken a wrong turn, or as a child you got lost, or can someone open and, you know, share? No one got lost. All are found. Praise the Lord.
I think, Vivek, we do get lost when the Google doesn't work properly. We follow the Google and blindly go. And if there is some changes, it takes us round and round and round, and we don't know where we are going. It happens quite sometimes.
Yeah. That's great. Thank you for opening your mouth and, you know, sharing, because this is a sharing session. If people don't share, then we can't have this session. So it's like everyone joins, just takes the word and walks away. The word will not become flesh in your life unless you open your mouth and share it. So we got to chew the word, just like a shepherd chewing the cud, you know. It's just like chewing the grass, you see. So that's how the word is. So unless you open your mouth, that word will not become flesh. So I'm talking about, you know, that's great. In today's world, if you lose your, and it's happened so many times, I take a wrong exit on the expressway and you've got to go miles to the next exit, take a turn and come back again. But I say, wow, it's, you know, there are two ways of looking at it. You say, wow, that's a good thing. I've got to drive a little more and got to see a little more places. And then you can come back happily, assuring you that, you know, it was worth a while taking a longer turn. So thanks, Veera, for that. But has anyone else got lost, you know, physically getting lost? Sometimes when you were a child, you know, dad and mom has told us to be at a place, and, you know, you went somewhere else and suddenly you got lost. You went somewhere and, you know, you are crying. You don't know where's dad, where's mom. And you actually got lost. And that's the scene which the Holy Spirit was taking me to. And I just thought I'll ask someone if anyone has gone through that experience, you know, of getting lost somewhere. If you go back down, you know, suddenly you remember, yes, I did get lost once. And, you know, I just want you to share that experience so that this psalm becomes alive in our life. That's the only reason. Otherwise, we can do the psalm in 20 minutes and it's over. But unless we contemplate, then only we'll benefit most from this, you know, psalm, the Lord is my shepherd. Would anyone like to share?
Hello, Vivek.
Yeah, go ahead.
Manita. I was lost, yes, at Mount Mary's. I was with my grandmother, and after the veneration, and we came out, we found that my parents had gone ahead, and my grandmother and I were left alone. And of course, both of us were crying. She was around 75 years old, and I was with her all alone. We were scared, but finally we made an announcement, and we found my parents after an hour.
Okay, and when you got back to your parents, what was that relief in your soul? How did you feel?
Oh yeah, I was around, I think, yeah, at that time. And I was really very happy, overjoyed. I was in tears. My face was all, you know, I was all worked up. And of course, my grandmother could not stand. We just had to sit in one place waiting to find my parents. We could not walk around because it was terribly crowded at the mount during the fair time, you know. Yeah.
Thanks for sharing. Thank you so much. Yeah. Anyone else would like to share?
Hi, I'm Nimfa from Bahrain. Yeah. I would like to share, this is 2 years experience, and I was driving, going back to my place. We had an intercession in our church at nighttime, and one of the ministries that I'm engaged in is to send these members who are going back home. And it happened that I have to send back this brother near the Saudi causeway. And it was my first time to drive in there when it was the middle of the night when I supposed to go back home. But then the road here is just going straight, and then finding going to the end to go back to my place. But it happened that I followed the road going to Saudi Arabia, and knowing the rule that women who are driving going there should be covered, it just, you know, created a fear inside me. And I was so afraid approaching this guy on the toll gate. But I honestly said that I was lost and I'm finding my way going back. And he gave me an instruction that I have to follow this road on the next intersection. There is a shortcut going to Manama. But then knowing the culture of how Saudis that drive, they are racing behind me, and I was terrified again. I just kept on driving, and all of a sudden, I noticed that my car was passing through the bridge connecting from Bahrain to Saudi, and I was terrified. All of a sudden, I was praying, and the Holy Spirit led me to the end. Before reaching the immigration, there is a road going back to Bahrain. And it was such kind of relief after that. And I gazed on the other side, and I saw how beautiful the causeway. It's like, oh, I miss the best part in driving that way. I should be going back and drive again and enjoy the scene.
Oh, wow. How did you feel once you came back, when you reached back again? Was that fear taken away when you reached properly?
Yes, I was definitely relieved. And it is some kind of accomplishment on my part, because not anyone, especially women, can drive on that side, knowing the rules that all women should cover their hair. And during that time, I didn't wear any abaya. I was in my casual wear, and my hair was bare. So it was some kind of accomplishment on me.
Thanks. I mean, thank you so much for sharing that. God bless you, really. Thank I'm going to come back to all the sharings, because I'm trying to come to a point, and unless we come alive to our own feelings and go back. See, I can just tell you, so many people are not open now to understanding. So many times we are lost in life. sometimes daily, sometimes during our childhood. But now the Holy Spirit is opening up things and giving you one by one and telling you, yes, here you are lost. And you need to open up and share. I promise you, at the end of this psalm, you'll have the strong anointing of the Holy Spirit. Because if you take part, that's where the power of the word of God comes in, you know.
Amen.
Amen. So that's all I can tell you. You know, I've seen the word of God coming alive only when you become a part of it, you know. So yeah, so would anyone else would like to share?
Yes, Vivek, I would like to share.
Yeah.
Well, so this was years back when Shania was like 5 years old and when she got lost in a shopping center in Sunshine Coast. Mm-hmm. We were, had the fright of our life and we all panicked. I panicked so much that I didn't even have the time to pray or ask the Holy Spirit to help me. I just kept going around and then finally after about 40, 45 minutes, we found her. But what I'm trying to say is today, if the same incident took place, I wouldn't be afraid because I have become so dependent on the Holy Spirit that I keep talking to him every day, asking him to handle every situation and planning my whole day, my life. And I can see lovely things. I can see little miracles happening every day in our lives. Amen. So when you are so dependent on the Holy Spirit, you need not worry about anything. So that's what I would like to say. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. This is so powerful when you share, because when you share, you actually are bringing the word of God to life and that word will come alive. And then you will attend sessions like these and you would see Jesus Christ coming alive, the Holy Spirit coming alive. And yes, so we're just talking about, we just shared one thing about physical kind of, you know, I know three of you shared. God bless you all for sharing. There are also sometimes when we are lost spiritually, okay? You are either taking a wrong road of life or you got into a certain fear, a sudden fear that has gripped you. And at that point of time, you're totally nervous, you're lost, and you don't know what's happening. You suddenly feel that, you know, there's nothing. You just, nothing comes, just fear, you know? Have you ever experienced such a situation where fear has gripped you so much that, you know, you could call yourself physically there, but you're mentally lost, absolutely lost. You really don't know where you are. And, or maybe it could be a time of your life where you went into a depression and like, you just can't come out of that tunnel because you can't see the light at the other end. The devil keeps on condemning you and you don't see any hope out of it. Now, I want you to know that is there been such a situation in your life? God wants to know today. So that if there was any fear in the past, it's going to come up and we are going to heal it at the end of the session. We say a prayer and we are out. All of us are going to come out victorious because God is our shepherd and we will lack nothing. Would anyone like to share a spiritual distancing now, not a physical kind of a distancing?
Yes, Vivek. Spiritually, I lost many a times.
Only one. Give me one because there are so many others. But give one good one where you feel you would like to share it, please.
I can only say that, okay, I was looking for the destination only, forgetting about my journey. So many years, this was happening till I stumbled upon that I fell ill. And that is the time, you know, I realized that my journey has to be spirit-filled, Holy Spirit-filled.
Amen. And today, how do you feel being in the Holy Spirit, Joe?
It's a journey still. Long way to go.
I totally agree, but I know...
It is a joy. Each day is a joy.
Is there a joy in your journey? It doesn't matter. We're all on a journey.
You are surely. It is a joy each day. And each day, we are encountering small miracles.
Amen.
And that is what all about. We are continuously in the journey.
Thank you, Lord. Yeah. And this journey is beautiful with the Lord, isn't it?
Sure, it is.
Anyone else would like to share?
I think I'll share a little as well on my journey.
Yeah,
before we came to Australia, and we lived in the Middle East as well. There were certain things that I was working on in terms of profession, and a few things that I tried, and everything that I kept trying just seemed to be like a rolling stone gathering no moss. And it was like a direction in life that seemed hopeless. There was no light at the end of the tunnel. There was no direction, and nothing seemed to be working. And it also seemed like it was a stage where, you know, whatever you prayed for, and there was no answer to that prayer. And the question mark then was, is God really listening to me, or has he sort of, you know, created a firewall and left me on the other side of it and say, you're on your own? And I'm sure there are many out there that do feel that same situation.
Yes, of course. Amen.
Yes. So yeah. It lasted many years. It was a challenging time, and things did sort of, I did carry a little baggage with me when we then moved into Australia here, and it took us a little while before things started getting better, but that's when the journey started leading me towards the destination of God. And I think the pivotal point, or the turning point, was when I attended Brother Johnson's retreat last year in March at the church in Aspley. That's when the anointing struck me in a big way, where my whole path changed, direction changed. It's like the GPS that kept spinning like a compass without a magnetic direction now suddenly seemed to be pointing in one direction. And that was amazing grace. It was, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I live that hymn every time I sing it. I live this journey.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Anyone else would like to share, or we could?
Yeah. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Good.
All right. This is Samantha. I received confirmation, you know, of course, with the Holy Spirit when I was, you know, in teens. But I think 10 years ago is when I actually got filled with the Holy Spirit. And I think from then on, my life, I don't think has ever been different ever. I don't think that completely changed. Did I experience any physical, you know, being lost and stuff? Absolutely. Because I think when I received the Holy Spirit, it's like you hear, sometimes it's hard, right? Because you hear two different voices. But I will say that throughout the entire journey for the 10 years, you know, praying in tongues has definitely always just given me revelation at the time and the moment of that journey. I cannot imagine my Christian walk without the Holy Spirit, because I don't think I would be able to hear from God as well as we can without him. And, you know, we talk about the Holy Spirit, and we used to see doves and, you know, all these things, but he's, you know, like you mentioned yesterday, he is a person. And just like you would want to build a relationship with your best friend, that's exactly what that is. So yeah, you know, whether physical, will you get lost? Of course, because the enemy is going to come and argue every single thing the Holy Spirit says. But would I count it all joy, like Paul says, who spoke the most in tongues in the entire Bible? Like, you know, he says he spoke the most in tongues. Yeah, that was like, I mean, it's more than, you can't even explain it. So yeah, were there troubles? Jesus says, hey, guys, I didn't say if you get in troubles. I said when you get in troubles. But like, you know, the other people I mentioned, it is probably the best experience of my life.
Amen. Thanks, Samantha. You're from which part? You're in US, right?
Yes.
Okay. Praise God. Different parts of the world, people connecting. Thank you so much, Jesus, for this session that we have with the Word of God. Now, I guess we'll open this to understanding the Word as the Lord is my shepherd. Okay. Now, I want this to be a little contemplative, because I want this. Why did I ask a question? Why we lost, you know? Amazing Grace is a beautiful hymn. Okay, we are lost and then we are found by God. And when you say the Lord is my shepherd, okay, what do you mean by the Lord is my shepherd? Okay, can someone open up this and share who is this wonderful relationship you have with, and what does the Lord mean to you when you say, when David says this psalm, he doesn't say Lord is the shepherd, Lord is shepherd, Lord is my shepherd. It's become very personal. That word my is so powerful there. And why, how is your relationship with the Lord? Can we just open up this with a couple of people sharing, and then we'll understand this, and then we go through it, because this is a small psalm. So we just want to go in the depth of it so that we all enjoy this sharing. Would someone like to share, please?
Okay, can I say, it's me again, Samantha.
Yeah, good.
When you just said my, it made me think of my mom, my dad. Why do I say my mom, my dad? It's because they're mine. Because they are somebody that I can rely on. Like, I don't have to worry even if life is the hardest. I know mom and dad are there for me. And so when you just mentioned, because I meditated on the shepherd thing, it's like, in a, my mom and dad, because I know no matter what happens, I know that they're there for me. Like, no matter, even if I've done the worst thing ever, like mom and dad, my mom and dad are there for me. And just looking in the natural, like Holy Spirit talks to me, like, you know, he'll give me foreshadowing and stuff in the natural. That's how I look at Christ. Like, he's my shepherd. That's what I take from that.
Okay, amen. Such a powerful sharing that is. Really, that's purely Spirit-filled. Thanks, Amanda. Yeah, anyone else would like to share?
Hey, Vivek, Paul here. The Lord is my shepherd. To me, means that he is someone who's constantly watching out for me, looking after me, and taking care of me. And he pretty much is doing everything for me. And that's why when we refer to him as my shepherd, he is my all. And there's really nothing I need to worry about as long as I acknowledge him as my Lord and shepherd.
Yep. So true. Thank you. Thank you for sharing.
Little addition from me.
Yeah.
When I say Lord is my shepherd, I consider myself as a sheep who is helpless without the shepherd. So for all my needs, for all my spiritual nourishment, I need my shepherd. Without my shepherd, I am lost and I am nothing. That's
fantastic. All. So yeah, that opens me up to a question now, which is really where I wanted to take the sharing to. How do you define the animal sheep, or when we come to lamb, what do we understand from that animal? Why did the Lord say, you know, he could have said any other, why he said sheep? Why did, obviously a shepherd would be controlling the flock of sheep. Why didn't he say goats? Why didn't he say deer? He could have chosen any other animal. Why shepherd? Why sheep? I mean, just the question, why? Why did the Lord, you know, why did David say that the Lord is my shepherd? Means obviously, as Veera shared, you've got to be the sheep. So can we discuss something about sheep? What does it come to your mind? When you speak about sheep, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Can we share something about sheep?
Sheep are very humble and...
Yeah.
Cool, like, you know.
Not humble.
Yeah. Sheep are very meek and like gentle, quiet. Yeah.
Thank you. Yes.
And they follow.
And they, yeah. Usually they follow the shepherd.
Yes. Thank you. That's again a good revelation. Sheep always follow the shepherd. Yes. That's great. Something else that comes to your mind. Now, I know there are so many participants on this call from different parts of the world. I'm sure someone will have something to say about a sheep. If you don't have to say something about the questions, can you at least describe a sheep? What does it come to you when, you know, someone says, you know, look at the sheep, something would come to your mind. Can you please share?
Sheep are very harmless.
Yes, absolutely right.
I think sheep are, to me, helpless.
Helpless, yes. Absolutely right.
Sheep can also be scattered easily.
They can be scattered easily. Yes, absolutely right.
Yeah, they can be distracted very fast, as Raj said. They can be, you know, scattered easily. So it can be disturbed or distracted very easily.
That's absolutely right. Yes, you can scatter the sheep very easily. If there's no shepherd, they have no focus. They don't know where to go. Yes, absolutely right. Anyone else? I'm just opening up with easy questions so that someone can at least share who's finding it hard to share with other questions.
I think sheep they don't have very good eyesight, so they only listen to the master's voice, the shepherd's voice.
That's right. Yes, absolutely right. Anyone else? Sheep are timid. Yes, Priya, that's absolutely right.
They cannot take care of themselves.
Yes.
They don't know when they are hungry or they don't know when they are thirsty. The shepherd takes care of them and takes them to other green pastures or when they want. Or he senses that they are thirsty and he takes them to the waters.
Yeah. Now, what's the difference between a sheep and a goat then? We all have meat, okay? So some have lamb, some have sheep, some have goat. So what differs a lamb from goat? Okay, when you go to buy meat, it's always, do you want lamb or you want goat? Or beef, okay? But obviously we're talking about, you know, something similar. Is there any difference between goat and lamb?
Goats are aggressive.
Yeah. With the eating pattern, can I just take you down to those parts of eating? What does a sheep eat and what does a goat eat?
Goats are scavengers.
Yeah, goats are scavengers, yes.
Sheep eats the food that's given to them, grass and...
Yeah, okay. So sheep basically only eat green grass and they will only eat something fresh, okay? This is something I want to teach you today, is that they will not eat anything stale. They will go hungry, but not eat anything stale. The grass has to be green. They don't even eat any other type of grass. So they have to be led in pastures by the shepherd. Okay. And once they stop grazing at one point, if there is no food, they will stay there. Sometimes they may even die because they don't go to the next place. The shepherd has to take the sheep beyond the mountain and show them the next place where they have to graze. So you can imagine the dependence of the sheep on the shepherd. Okay. Many times the sheep suffer from a disease which they get from, you know, in their head. Okay. This is a kind of parasite that gets into the sheep's head and it basically kills sheep as well. So many times if you see a sheep, it is always banging its head across the wall and it's bleeding all the time. Now, a shepherd who understands that it's been bitten by a parasite and the parasite is a kind of a flea, okay, which keeps passing on to the other sheep. And this creates a kind of a brain disease with the sheep and they die because of this. So what does the shepherd do is he makes a concoction of oil and sulfur, mixes it, and he applies this on its head all the time so that the sheep are actually, you know, they get well and, you know, the kind of parasites die only when, you know, when that concoction is used. Now, who would understand the sheep as well as a shepherd? Because a shepherd knows the voice of the sheep. And today, if we understand the definition of sheep, then we can be the sheep and the Lord can be our shepherd. That's why I'm saying, who is the sheep and are we that sheep? Okay. Now, do we depend on God for everything? Do we say, Holy Spirit? Good morning, Holy Spirit. Okay. Yesterday, we did such a powerful session on the Holy Spirit. Okay. Simple prayers, but the anointing so powerful. So it just goes to say that even without even touching people, there were people, so many people slain in the spirit, so many giving testimony after testimony that the mighty hand of God, you know, came across. So you can imagine how powerful the word of God is. It is true and alive. Now, are we that sheep which we can go to God and say, Lord, you are my shepherd and I will lack nothing. Okay. Can we go down and, you know that in my heart, okay, that the Lord is my shepherd. Okay. Now, what are the fears that come in when you see a sheep? Okay. Does the sheep have any sort of enemies or does the sheep have enemies?
Wolves, right?
It could be wolves. It can be those coyotes. I mean, those small foxes. It could be anyone. Yeah. So now what does the shepherd has to be so careful because, you know, the sheep will not fight back. As someone said, they are so docile. They will not fight back. They would rather die. but they will not fight back. So, and most of the predators know that this is an easy picking if there's a sheep, because first of all, the meat is clean, fresh, and it's a good and easy kill, because you don't have to run fast like the others, and they will not defend themselves. Do we have an enemy as well?
Yes, of course.
Who's our enemy?
The devil.
So are we fighting in the physical realm or in the spiritual realm?
We do that
spiritual. Spiritual.
Okay. Russell, Ephesians 6:12.
We are not wrestling.
Are you all enjoying?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm just trying to go through it so that we understand this whole thing well. So, yeah, but just read, Russell. Who's our enemy?
For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms.
Amen. So we have an enemy that is there, and he is active, okay, all the time. And so we have got to be careful that the Lord, who is our shepherd, knows how to fight this enemy. Do you agree that Jesus definitely destroyed him on the cross? But what is the enemy's role to get us out of the sheepfold of God and take us out of something called the hiding place of God? Take me to Psalm 91, please. The first verse. The secret place. Does it mention secret place? Just see that version, secret place. Can you take me to another version, please? Secret place. What are you on? Maybe King James. Read.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High.
Okay, the word secret place of the Most High, secret place of the Most High God, is nothing but the sheepfold of God in the spiritual realm. Okay, he is holding us, and he is there right there with him. You know, right in front. The devil cannot touch, because the secret place is guarded by the blood of Jesus. Okay? And that secret place is what we need to dwell in. Can you just read it ahead so that, yeah, shall abide
under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress.
So can we just personalize this and say, he is my refuge? Can you say, you are my refuge, you are my shepherd, you are my fortress, you are my God? And read further. In him
will I trust.
In him, some version says, alone will I trust. Okay, so the word I, alone will I trust, is I'm personalizing this and saying, God, you are my refuge, you are my shepherd, and in you alone blindly will I trust. Okay. And then does he give us an assurance in verse 3?
Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence.
Yes. I just needed only this. Do you know what's a fowler? Can you go back to 23, please? Psalm 23. 23, yeah. Okay, the snare of the fowler. Who's a fowler? Do you know who the fowler?
The devil.
Yes.
Devil, and what does he do? He will tempt.
Exactly. That's good. But a devil always leaves you in a particular scheme, okay, of things. He traps you. Okay. There's a trap always when the devil says, and he says, walk into it. Okay, like how he tempted Eve. Eat of this fruit. Okay. Now, God clearly said, do not eat of that fruit. But he says, no, eat out of this fruit. So the devil uses scripture very well. So if we do not know scripture, then he's going to, you know, be on top of us. And many times he says, please come out of that very pen. He knows we are under God's protection. The only way he can get us out is to get us out of that sheepfold. And the sheepfold is nothing but that very protection of God, the secret place of the Most High God. Are you getting it?
Amen.
Okay. The secret place is that spiritual realm where the Lord has got his angels protecting you, the legion of angels protecting you. And I had this wonderful testimony from the brother today about how the angels work and how powerful they are. Do you all know that we have angels for our protection? And God has given us the authority over angels. Do you know we can command the angel and tell the angels, protect me and my sheepfold, okay, from the fowler. Okay, and that is what we need to do. Call on to the angels, call on to that help which the Lord has given us. And the Lord is our shepherd and we shall not want anything. Okay, now I got to the point is the Lord is my shepherd. Remember the mind that, you know, Samantha spoke of is like a child who depends on the parent. He knows that the parent will take care of him. If the parent says, if he's in a building and it's caught fire, if the father says, jump, what will the child do? Will he think, no, you know? My point is, if the father says, jump, okay, and the son cannot see him because there's a lot of smoke, okay, but will he jump?
Yes, if he trusts the dad, yes.
Exactly. And why will he jump?
Because dad wouldn't say something to hurt him.
No, I'm talking about he's jumping from the second floor. There's a fire in the building. They can't get him. But he's jumped. The father says, son, jump. Just jump. Just jump. And he just jumps. Okay. My point is, okay, he jumps. But why is he jumping?
Because he has the faith.
Because?
He has the faith that his father will catch him.
Yes, exactly.
Exactly.
Correct. But today, if you are on the second, you know, even you're on the first floor, somebody says, jump, will you jump?
No, not somebody. Not someone else's voice.
The point is, you know, today what happens is when you grow up, you have a mind that thinks, okay, if I jump, okay, maybe he'll catch me, but what if he doesn't catch me? Are you getting me? There's also a mind that rationalizes, I may break my leg, break a bone. Okay, what if this can happen? It's better I go down the stairs. Even though you know it's dangerous, you will not trust the jumping. But as a child, there's no question of danger. There's only one part. Okay, the Lord is my shepherd. I know if I jump, my daddy will catch me. The child doesn't think the second way. But do we all think of the second option as well? Okay, the first thing that comes in the mind is, what if he doesn't catch me? Does the child think that way? Are you getting me?
Yes.
The Lord is my shepherd. It means that I am that child and the Lord is my provider. Okay. He will put food on my table. He will give me employment. Even if I lose my job, he'll get me another job. Even if I have no money, he will feed me. He will provide because he is the provider. He has bought me at a price. He has paid that price. He is my shepherd. And if I go to him in his sheepfold, he will take care of me. Amen.
Amen.
So that's exactly what I'm saying. So this is what I want you to know, that you will not want. Okay. Please remember, I shall not want. If this scripture anytime comes, it can hurt you. But then if you know the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Every time it should refresh you and you know that the Lord will take care of me. If you're going through a situation, your eyes will speak to you. Do your eyes speak to you? Do your eyes speak to you?
Yes, they do.
Yes, if you see something wrong, they speak to you. And that's where your faith gets tested. But the Lord says, just will live by faith, not by sight. So you have to keep on saying, the Lord, you are my shepherd and I shall not want. I know, Holy Spirit, you will take me out of this situation. I don't have to depend on it. Just like Cheryl said, today, if she had that similar situation, she would not fear because she knows the one she'll send will come back with a result. And that is the assurance that God gives us today, that we have someone who is our shepherd and he's not going to leave us, not abandon us. His word says, I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. I will not abandon you till the end of time. And that should be the strength we have to draw from, that the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Amen. Can we go through this second part now? He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. What do we understand from this? When you say green pastures, what comes to your mind just now? Can you think of a meadow or a beautiful, you know, plain full of greenery? When you travel by train or when you actually, you know, travel down the countryside, you see a lot of greenery all around. How does it make you feel when you see green?
Peaceful.
Amen. Peaceful, yes. If your mind is running so fast, you're stressed out. But if you see something beautiful, you see a lovely green pasture, you go to a garden and you see greenery all around. You can smell, you know, it's rained and you can smell the earth. You can see beautiful birds around. You can see, you know, everything green around you. How do you feel, you know, won't that stress be away when you look at this green pastures?
Yeah, you feel de-stressed, and also you can say that the place is like a really, you know, fertile and very peaceful, as Samantha said.
Yeah. So again, if you go through a river and you just hear the river, has anyone gone through next to a river and hear the river water coming down from the mountains when it, you know, just makes that certain noise, you know, the water flowing? Okay. How does it feel?
You very soothing.
Yeah, if you have actually seen the river water and you know you put your legs in it and you could just feel the water, the noise of the water coming down, you know, from the mountains, you know, just like a waterfall, and there's no one, just you, and you could see the water just flowing through, you know, how, you know, it make you feel,
yeah, calm. It's refreshing.
Yeah,
refreshing.
Fantastic, thank you so much. Okay. Someone else?
Very relaxing.
Yes. This is the still waters I'm talking about. The still waters from the river are very refreshing, very relaxing. If you just go to the river waters and you just, you know, hear that similar sound, you know, it's just the pebbles on top of the pebbles, the water's falling, or it is just flowing slowly, just, you know. And you've got your feet in the water. Think of this image right now, that your feet are in the water. You're splashing it in. And you could hear that same voice, that same water, you know, still waters, you know, that are there. It's very calm. The place is beautiful. You know, if you're gone, now I'll take you through a lake. It is so still there, you know. You could just feel the stillness of the waters. Have you experienced the stillness?
Yes, many times.
And not only just that, it's like the Lord always says, be still and know I am God. Okay. And he wants us to connect at that level. And why does he want silence? Okay. Many times the best of prayers are made in silence. Okay. We do speak our scriptures from the mouth and we do believe in faith and we just speak them out, because without speaking, we don't get the manifestation. But we also need to sit quiet and wait on the Lord. Do you agree with me? For him to speak to us. And when he talks about this, what the Holy Spirit is trying to tell me is, my people, just be quiet. Know that I am God. I like the stillness. I know everything. Okay. I know everything about you. I just need you to be quiet and I'm going to be speaking to you. Now, that is where the Lord wants to talk. And that is the still waters he talks about. And unless we open ourselves up to this stillness and know that God is looking for this, then he speaks to us and refreshes us. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay.
Now let's get to understand. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his namesake. Okay. Can someone share the first part? He restores my soul. What do you mean? Someone said he got lost, and today I asked the same question. You know, someone shared, say, you said Shania's lost, right? And, you know, she came back. Now, the restoration means when the child comes back to the parent, okay, the child was lost and comes back. Now, this is in a physical sense, okay? How did you feel at that time, Jude and Cheryl?
The joy, the happiness we had.
Okay.
I feel relieved.
If you just go now right to that situation in spirit, you could see yourself, tears in your eyes, and said, Lord, thank you so much. You know, like, it's you know, if you go back to that situation right now, you actually see yourself with tears in your eyes there at that moment, tears of joy that, you know, you got to restore. You got to, you know, restoration is a process where, you know, you come back, you know. And how would that feeling be? Would that feel a feeling of joy?
Yes, Vivek.
Yeah. So it's a wonderful feeling when your soul gets restored back to God. Okay. And the restored my soul, basically he's restoring my soul when you come back to him. And the Lord is that shepherd who waits on that sheep that leaves the flock, because he says, I don't go after the ones that are lost. The ones that are in the sheepfold, but I go after the one that is lost. So it may be the 99 that are in, he knows they are safe, but the one that is lost is what he goes finding for. Now, if we understand God in depth, he will try his best to get us back, because he knows that there are a lot of dangers. There are enemies out there. Okay, we are fighting not flesh and blood, but principalities. So when we go out there, we have to come back and get back into the house, because there is protection in the sheepfold. The devil can't touch you, because the blood of God, the blood of the Lamb is protecting us. That is Jesus. So he leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. So he says he restores my soul. Okay. Would someone have any more inputs on this? You know, apart from the notes I have made, I'm just looking for something I also can learn. That's why I've done this psalm today.
Hey, Vivek. So with that restore, when you were talking, it reminded me of, like, right now during the pandemic, you know how, like, you go to the store, at least in the US, and their shelves are empty.
Yep.
So you go and there's, like, nothing there. But to me, restore, like, practically showed me, it's like people restore, like, you know, reshelving things, right? So there's things being put back that was lost or not there.
Yep.
It's just, it's being put back. It's being restored.
Absolutely. Yep. Yes, absolutely. You know, before you share on this, let me go to some scriptural this. Russell, can you give me Isaiah 49:5? I'm going to make this psalm alive in our lives for all the people who are there on this call, so that you can open the psalm anytime, read it, and it will come back refreshing to you, knowing that God is my shepherd and I shall not want. Now, even if the devil puts you in any trap and tries to take you out, this is where you can remember he restores me back again. So you know that assurance from God that, you know, he is there to restore me when I come back. Restoring, let's go through the scriptures and then I will share with you what notes I have got on this. Yeah, Russell, read please.
And now, saith the Lord, that formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob again to him. Though Israel be not gathered, yet shall I be glorious in the eyes of the Lord, and my God shall be my strength.
Okay, so God is my strength. Even though Israel is not gathered, okay, I know I shall be glorious in the eyes of the Lord, and God will always and only always be my strength. Okay, I'm taking you to two or three verses, how it feels when you get restored to God. Okay, you're talking this to God. Psalm 61, verse 1.
Hear my cry, O God. Attend unto my prayer.
Okay. So here he cries unto God and he says, hear my cry, O God. You know, attend unto my prayer. This is the heart's cry out to God saying, restore me back. I want to come back into that, you know, into that secret place, you know. So it is a cry of, you know, it's basically that I want to convert myself. I'm in a mess. I want to come back, just like the prodigal son that we did last time. He wants to come back and come back to the Lord. So this is the cry of God. This is Psalm 60 verse 1. 60 it is, sorry, not 61. 60 verse 1.
O God, thou hast cast us off. Thou hast scattered us. Thou hast been displeased. O turn thyself to us again.
So here, so, you know, God has cast us off. If God, if you go away from the Holy Spirit, someone shared, you know, I cannot live without the Holy Spirit. And I would say, when you have a powerful anointing of the Holy Spirit, it's so important that we are always with that anointing all our life, because the word of God will be so alive for us that you will say, oh, that scripture. Wow, I got that scripture. Because the Holy Spirit looks for that scripture, and that scripture will actually, you know, get you back, and you'll be restored back again. And you'll feel so wonderful about it. So it says, oh, turn thyself to us again. And, you know, let us come back into that sheepfold. Okay. Into that very secret place that we dwell on. So let's go back again to Psalm 23 and understand, he restores my soul. What do we mean by the restores my soul? So basically, it means brings me to repentance. From the notes I have, it is just getting me back in that way. If we ever go across, or, you know, it's better to come back and say sorry to God, just like the prodigal son, and come up and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I've sinned against heaven and against you. And, you know, it's because the Lord is waiting with his arms open wide and saying, you know, if we take one step, we've seen last time that he comes running to put his arms around us and puts the ring, the robe, cuts the fatted calf, and there's celebration because we turned back and came back to him. So it is so great that we, you know, come back and repent. And the Lord just wants a repentance. He just wants you to change your heart and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I tried to do things on my own, but henceforth, I give you the glory because you are the one who needs all the glory. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. So in the paths of righteousness, okay. Do you know when Jesus says, first seek me and my righteousness, then all this will be added unto you. Okay. So he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. What do we understand for this? The path of righteousness. Do we know, we read that Jeremiah 29:11, I have a plan for you. Plan for your future, full of prosperity, full of, you know, God has a plan for us. Do you agree? Okay. And the plan is for our prosperity. And he just clearly tells us, so you can just open that one, 29:1, 29:11, sorry. Read.
For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end.
Okay, great. Go back to Psalm 23. And I just want to share one thing with you in this is, and what he tells me, the Holy Spirit tells me here is, God has a guidance for us. God, you know, he wants us to follow a path. Okay. He has his plan for us. But the thing is, man has a free choice, and that's where the problem is. Okay. God has a plan. God has a plan, you know, to prosper us. But the world says, no, that is not prosperity. Okay. The devil shows us a different kind of a scheme. He says, get into this. It's beautiful. You'll make money. You'll be rich. You'll have everything. But it's just, you, once you enter into that, then you realize that, oh, I've gone to the wrong place. But then the devil says, you know, see you later. That's your problem. You got in, that's your problem, your trap. So the thing is, we're going to be so careful to be open to our Lord for the path of righteousness, because this path of righteousness can only be given by God. And what does this mean is that we need to trust him and surrender everything to God. Speak to the Holy Spirit. Tell him, Holy Spirit, I have this problem today. Can you solve it for me? Try it out, all of you who are on this group. Come next week and share your testimony with me. In the name of Jesus, I assure you, we all have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Okay, and God has always been with us. And now the point is, do we trust God? Can we talk to him as a friend? Okay, and yesterday we shared the same thing, that if you make Jesus your personal Lord and Savior and say, Lord, you are everything to me. What do you mean by a Lord and Savior? That what you are my shepherd, I will follow you. How do you follow him? Through his word. Whatever his word says, you obey the word and follow the word. You live your life, you confess in accordance with the word, and then you see your life becoming a powerful testimony. And someone shared your small miracles daily with the Holy Spirit. This becomes a part of your normal life, because you know, if you talk to Holy Spirit, he's going to solve it. If you just ask him, before you ask or say, he knows it, you just say, Holy Spirit, I need this. And you always smile and you know, Holy Spirit, you're there with me. And that's what the Lord is trying to say. Can we make the Lord that personal shepherd in our life, where we can talk to him like a friend and say, this is the problem I'm going through. And he says, don't worry, I'm there with you. I'll take you out of it. So this is the path of righteousness. This is a direction which God wants to give us. And the path is a path of righteousness. Okay, whereas the devil has the path of evil. There's a very big difference in both of them. So that's what I want to share with you, the path of righteousness. Now, for his name's sake, can someone share something on that, for his name's sake? Can someone share?
So
for his name's sake, okay?
In the right path, as he has promised us, you know?
Yes, for his name's sake. When he puts his name to it, what happens there? Do you know? I'll just share one thing with you. It is not our merits, but his grace. Do you agree?
Yes, Vinay.
You are not walking into the Holy of Holies, and the amount of blessing, if you and I know the power we have within us, because the one we serve is so powerful that the Lord says his name is written in the heavens as mighty. His name, if you say the name of Jesus, every knee, it's not saying one knee, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is, you know, he is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father. In heaven, do you know what power we have as Christians, as believers, as when we put our trust in the Lord? Russell, can you open Philippians 2? Go to Philippians 2, 8 to 11 and read it. Please underline this. We have done this teaching, but I just want to bring it for his name's sake, because this psalm has everything in it. So what's his name to us? You know, how powerful is that name?
And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him.
Okay, remember, God had highly exalted him. God, okay, exalted our Lord Jesus, okay? And
given him a name which is above every name.
Which is above every name. This is heaven saying it. Okay. Read 10. And this is a blessing. This is the anointing. This is what our faith is. And this is what we claim. And this is, say, for his name's sake. Read verse 10 with power.
That at the name of Jesus, every knee should
bow. Okay. Stop there. At the name of Jesus. Say again. Every?
Every knee should bow.
Every, the word every means every knee. Can you just get this, that we read it at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. And read further.
Of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth.
And?
And that every tongue should...
Again, the word every, people forget this word, but the word every tongue, okay?
Every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Okay, so when you take his name, you walk into heaven straight away. You say, who are you coming? Name of Jesus. Okay, in, straight. Okay, whenever you walk in, you show an identity. Someone says, where you come from? This is my identity. Okay, walk in. This is our identity in Christ. When we walk in the Holy of Holies and when we make our prayer, you say, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, you're straight in the heavenlies now. You're straight in the Holy of Holies. You're in that spiritual realm straight away. If you understand this, your prayer life will be different, you know, from today onwards. Because you know, for his name's sake, okay, he has to, his name is the name above all names. And for his name's sake, you know, we have not earned this. We have not merited this. This is pure grace. Do you all agree?
Yes.
Yes,
this is not our merits. This is only his grace. We are just walking. Amen. We are only walking. If you understand this one word, you are taking away the whole teaching. Just this one word, that for his name's sake, you'd say, what, this name's sake? Yes, for his name's sake, you are walking in the heavenlies with the identity of Christ. And the heavens opens up and says, okay, you're in. And now your prayer is straight into heavenly, straight into the Holy of the Holies. We all know what it took to get to the Holy of Holies, and that was only an image of the Holy of Holies. This is the actual Holy of Holies. We don't deserve it. Unmerited, but it's grace, and we all have authority. Can you underline that word, for his name's sake? Have you got it?
Amen.
Amen. Can you go me back to Psalm 23 again? It's such a beautiful psalm. Don't you agree? Yes. Verse 4, Russell, please read.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
Okay, I want sharing on this now. We all are walking through very, very, very unknown times. We don't know what we don't know. Some people in the US don't know whether they have a job today, don't have a job. Okay, someone who had thought being in the US is the best place in the world. But today you don't even know whether you get infected, where you won't get infected. It's a highly, I don't know what I don't know. Okay. Now the fear of death is more than actually the death, than the death itself. Okay. The fear that grips you, because it's the unknown, and that's the way the fear is. Now God is giving us an assurance of the unknown. Many of us say we fear the unknown, and God says, I know the unknown, because God is beyond that. Because he has, you know, he has surpassed even that part. So this is only the shadow of death. Okay. Remember, it's not the actual death. It's the shadow of death. Can someone share what it feels like walking through the valley of the shadow of death? Have you ever gone through a situation like this in life where you feared the unknown so much? Someone was sick. You're not sure whether the person will come back. Someone have gone through this situation financially. You don't know where you'll have a job or don't have the job. Someone has gone into such a bad situation. You don't know where you'll be put in jail for something you are not said. You become a part of an investigation which you are absolutely not part of. And you know, you're thrown into something. Someone has gone into a place walking in a lonely area, and suddenly you see some people coming at you. Now, obviously, these are all different kinds of fears. I'm not here to bring the fear around, but God is talking about this valley of the shadow of death. Okay. Maybe the people are normal, but the way you see it, the devil puts it in your mind, oh, they're coming to kill you. Have any one of you experienced this?
Yes, Vivek, I would like to share.
Yeah, go ahead.
I shared it before too, as I went through my darkest time when I was sick. Yes. And but yes, I had assurance that, you know, God is with me, because as it's mentioned over here in the psalm, that as we walk through the valley of the shadow of the death, yes, it was like I thought that I was like, you know, like probably God's calling me, and I'm not going to survive, or, you know, in this pain, I'm going to go. But the assurance that, you know, I had that through Jesus' promise that he's always with me, and that he will never leave me alone. Mm-hmm. And that sort of assurance, you know, brought me out of all the negative and all the darkness and all the stuff that I was going through. And yes, his promise sort of, you know, brought me to life.
Yep. Mm. So nice. Thank you for the sharing. I just want you to understand the difference between death and shadow of death. Okay. Let's try to understand and just meditate on this part as some of my notes that I made in some different kinds of notes. But if you notice here, death in its substance has been removed. Okay. Only the shadow of it remains. Okay. Have you got that? It's saying the shadow of death. It's not saying death. Okay. Now, remember one thing. Do you know when there's a shadow, there also has to be a light somewhere? You can't have a shadow without light. Do you agree?
Yes. Yes, true.
Okay, get this. This is a deep contemplation. Okay. So, if there's a light somewhere, so there is some hope also on the other side. As you say, there's a dark tunnel, there's going to be light somewhere. If they're saying shadow of death, it means the light is there on me. There is death on one side, but it's only the shadow of the death. It's not the death itself. It's a shadow of the death. Okay. We may be passing through times. Every day we see the coronavirus, the number of people dying. That would be actual death there. But it's the shadow of that death that falls. Whenever you look at the numbers, you look at it and you are scared. You say, you know, what will happen next? But you know one thing, that's not death in itself. There's someone else who has died, but it's the shadow of that that puts us down. And, you know, if we walk through that, we are walking through these times also. In the same times as David talks about in the valley of the shadow of death. Remember, this is a valley, okay? What is a valley?
It's the depth of the mountains, you know, in between. It's the deepest part of the...
So it clearly says, David says, absolutely. So when I'm going depth here, the valley of every word in the psalm is beautiful. Okay. If someone understands this psalm, it's such a powerful psalm. It's the best psalm in this whole Bible. And in every word of this is so powerful. Okay. Here, what happens in the valley of the shadow of death is basically even in a fearful place like this, where death is everywhere around you. Okay. And you are just... In a valley, what happens? The mountains are all around you, okay? So you're basically submerged in this place and you're basically conquered, or kind of a conquered. But you know, even if you walk through this, it doesn't say, remember the word, he doesn't say, I walk in the valley of the shadow of death. He says, I walk through the valley. Can you see that? I walk through the valley. Yes, of the shadow of death. I don't walk in the valley of the shadow of death. Okay. When you walk through the valley, it's easier to walk in because you're just walking through it. Okay. You're walking in it. Okay. In that valley is the shadow of death, but I'm walking through it. That's what the Lord tells us here. And that was a very, very great revelation I got in when I was praying. I said, what a great revelation that it's not in the valley, but through the valley. Okay. And I said, amen to it. So the valley, the idea of the shadow of death, even in this fearful place, the shepherd, you know, clearly says that there's going to be no fear of evil, because God says, even if you walk in that situation, you're walking through it, because I am going to take you through that situation, not in that situation, but through it, you're going to come out. Amen.
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 Okay. As I said, death stands by the side of the highway in which we have to travel, and the light of heaven shines upon him, throws a shadow across our path. Okay. So remember, it's the light of heaven that is there on the other side. So what we need to do is always rejoice in this light, because the light is Christ. Okay. And I just want to ask you this question. Have you ever been afraid of a shadow?
If yes, you see a
shadow coming down on the road, do you stop walking? You said, no, there's a shadow. I'm not going to go.
Yes, Vivek, as kids, yes. Yes,
we yeah, but today, if you see a shadow on the road, would you would you know there's a shadow there? I'm not going to walk on this road because there's a shadow. Laura, you had a dog that chased you once, remember? You shared that with us.
Yes, yes.
Now, I just need to ask you one thing. If there's a shadow of the dog, would you be scared of the shadow of the dog?
No,
can
not.
Can the shadow of the dog bite you?
No, not anymore.
No, the shadow. I'm saying there's a dog, one very big dog out there. His shadow falls on the road. Are you scared of that? The shadow will definitely bite me?
No, not anymore.
Okay, so my point is it would not fear anyone, because the shadow of something will not fear you, because it's the shadow of that thing. Can the shadow, even if the dog tries biting you, he's behind the bar. Okay, yes. But his shadow is falling on the road. Yes. Why should you get scared? Even if he barks, he is not going to bite you, because it's his shadow that's falling on the road. Are you getting it?
Yes, that's true.
Even if he moves his mouth, that shadow cannot bite you.
Yes, that's true.
You agree with me?
Yes, true.
Okay. Can a shadow of a sword kill you? Someone is, the shadow of the sword is there on the road. Can that sword kill you?
No.
Because it's a shadow of the sword. Remember this. It's a shadow of death. It's not death itself.
Yes, that's true.
Okay. So it's the shadow of the dog. It's the shadow of the sword. Okay. So shadow of the death cannot destroy us. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
This is what we need to know, that the shadow of death has no power over us.
Yes, that's true.
The devil tells us it is death. I'll tell you, the fear of something is more worse than the actual thing. Do you agree?
Yes, true.
If you're fearing the unknown, and God says, I own even the unknown.
Yes, true.
And that's where you have the Holy Spirit in your life. So remember one, even through you walk through the, you're not walking in the valley, you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. That shadow of the death, it could be a shadow of a sword, shadow of a person with a gun, okay, a shadow of a dog, a big massive dog, a shadow of something evil, but the shadow of it cannot do anything to us.
Yes, true.
Only the shadow, the death has been taken away, so the shadow of death has no power over us. And that's what the Lord trying to tell us today. This was a fantastic revelation. Amen. That's why I did this psalm today. And I said, Lord, wow, what a teaching. You're giving me something new. And today I tell you, if you open this psalm even 100 times, every time you open it, there'll be something new. Do you agree with me?
Yes, amen. Amen. Yes.
So if you just open this psalm and say, no, I have already studied this psalm. So, but I tell you, if you're open to the Holy Spirit, you'll enjoy the word of God. It'll be a beautiful experience, because every time you're opening it, he teaches you something new. And today he taught me this. I'm sharing this with you. It is walking. One is, I always thought I was walking in the valley, but I never knew the words. He says, look through the valley. It's not in the valley. You can easily walk through a situation, okay, rather than being in the situation.
In the situation, yes.
You can always go through the valley of the shadow of death, because shadow has no power.
Yes, amen.
Because death does not exist. It is the shadow, because there's a light of heaven on the other side.
Yes.
And that's what I've got to focus on, not the death. So he says, don't look with your eyes at the death, but look at me with your spiritual eyes, because you call the unseen into the seen. Amen.
Amen.
This is powerful anointing. And this is what I'm teaching you today, is nothing purely, but just from the Holy Spirit, absolutely raw teaching that the Holy Spirit gave me.
Amen.
And I'm giving that thing to you all.
Amen. Amen.
So all we go through life is, we always think of death, but there's only a shadow. This is what the devil teaches us, that he shows us, he is only a shadow. He has no power.
Yes.
The power is with only our Lord.
Amen to that. Amen.
And he said, I will fear no evil. Okay. What does he mean by this? That even if you have even despite the dark association with the idea of the valley of the shadow of death, okay, under the care of the Lord, who's my shepherd, okay, the Lord says, even in this place, okay, of evil, I will not fear. I will not fear. Now, why will you say that will not fear? Because thou art with me. Okay. I know you are with me. Now, unless you are so much in the Lord and so much you really depend on God, why would you fear? Every time I fear, Laura, I just want to share this with you.
Yes, tell
every
me.
Time I think about, you know, what is going to happen tomorrow. And God has told me, has any bird not eaten food? Has any bird in the wild starved and died?
No.
Any bird in the world? Yes, the man who catches that bird, puts it in the cage, may cage. Stop feeding it, yes. And the cage will, the bird will die, okay? Because the man caught it from its natural habitat, put it in a cage,
yes.
And forgot to feed it, and then it died. Possible.
Yes.
Okay, and yes, it's very much possible. But does a bird in the wild ever die of starvation?
No. No, because the Lord has...
Who provides for the food for the bird? Does the bird have a fridge? We have our best fridges. You know, 5-star, 4-star, big fridge, 1800, 1000 ml fridge, bigger the fridge. We have 2 fridges and we can keep our food there because we know we can store it. Does the bird have anything to store? Does it have a fridge?
No, the Lord provides. Yes.
Now, I want to say is that if God can feed the birds and the sparrows and the crows and the ravens, and not a single one known has died because they never got food.
Yes.
And it's not easy when you understand and look at all the BBC TV, how, you know, the deer becomes food for the lion.
Yes. Okay.
And everyone in that whole ecosystem gets food.
Yes, correct.
How does that happen? And we get scared tomorrow morning, oh my God, if my job goes, who's going to put food on the table?
Yes.
But if God has given you the job, can he get you a better job?
Yes.
That's exactly what the Lord is telling us here. I will fear no evil because you are with me.
With me, Lord. Amen.
Okay. Now, let's go to this part when he says, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Okay. Whenever you take a dog for a walk, Jude.
Yes, please.
Jude and Cheryl, are you all there?
Yes.
Okay, when you take your doggy for walks, do you carry a stick with you?
No.
Okay, the doggies are stronger, so it's okay. I mean, I have to talk to someone else who carries a rod or a stick. Okay.
No.
But you normally see people taking a dog, they also take a stick along with them, correct?
Depends where you are, I guess. So if you are scared of any...
Yeah, but why do you carry a stick? Because in India especially, at least here, you know that there won't be any other dogs on the road. Very rarely, there'll be someone on a leash. But in India, if you're taking your dog for a walk, there are a lot of stray dogs, correct?
Oh, yeah.
And you're entering their territory. Every stray dog marks his territory. So you enter the territory, then those dogs come close to your pet dog. Okay. But when they see your stick, what happens?
They get scared.
Okay. So that's how the Lord uses his rod and the staff, because they comfort me. You know, God has got a rod and a staff, and he says, you stay inside, you don't worry. You are under my wings. Nothing can go wrong with you. Isn't that an assurance? In Psalm 91, he says, when you are in that secret place, and when you are abiding in the shadow of the Almighty, and you're under his wings, he will protect you because you're in his sheepfold. Do you understand this? Because he has a rod and a staff, Satan can come no close to you. Nothing can come near you. No evil can come near you because he is protecting you. And he has a rod and his staff. He has his angels. Do you know we have legions of angels? We just call unto them and God will get those angels. You know, Russell, take me Hebrews 1:14 quickly. I want to show you the power that you have and we can all use this.
Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation?
We are heirs of salvation and yet sent forth to minister for them. Okay, do you know what's the meaning of that? That the angels should obey what you say. Russell, you agree?
Yes, we do. Do agree.
You agree with the scripture and this power of the scripture? Do you know we can call the angels to protect us all the time, and they will have to protect us, okay? And there are so many testimonies of people seeing, you know, angels all around, and that's the protection, okay? And that's how powerful, you know, this scripture is, okay? Yeah, let's go ahead because we got to finish this. Remember Hebrews 1:14, just underline it in your Bible. Very powerful scripture. Call unto the angels. We'll do another session next time of teaching you how to pray and how the angels will listen to our prayer. You'll be wonderful. Once you get on top of this word of God, life will be a blessing. You'll only say it is such a blessing. Amen. Can I get an amen?
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thou prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemy. Thou anoint my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Okay. Now to go with this, what he means by this. Okay. Remember, if you have a wonderful table, if you are in an army camp, okay, you are serving, you're served with the best of food. Okay. Now tell me one thing. There's war around. There's an enemy all around you. Would you be able to eat that food?
No, you'd be living in fear.
Okay, because have you ever seen a soldier? He said, no, let me just finish my 3-course meal. And then enemy, you come after the 3-course meal, we'll fight with you after that. Does the enemy wait like that? And you say, okay, fine. Soldier is going for a 3-course meal and then I'll wait for him and then we'll fight.
No, it doesn't happen that way.
Okay, he'll wait for that soldier to go in because he knows when he's eating, he will not think of fighting, so he can kill him. So here, it's a very contrasting thing. It says, thou prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. What does it mean?
I think what he is trying to say here is, even though you're surrounded by your enemies in difficult situations as well, he is just keeping that joy in our heart and asking us to have that confidence that he is there for us.
Exactly. Because the joy of the Lord is my strength. Exactly. It's spirit-filled. That's the statement you made. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Even in the situation, in the worst and the darkest situation, or even in a war, God will not take away your joy. Okay? Because you know who you are in, and that the joy of the Lord, because this is just a body, okay? It is that spirit that belongs to God. And you know one thing, that joy of God is perfect in you, okay? So even thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies, you anoint your head with oil, and my cup will always run over, okay? So God has always provided, and he will always provide, and your cup will always run over, okay? When you call on to the name of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So this is the condition of God's servant. Remember, as a warrior, we all call ourselves warrior. We are always in conflict. Not all of us will understand the word of God. Many of your own families will say, "Are that person." I remember back in the day when there was charismatic meetings happened, they used to call them crackmatics, not even charismatics, crackmatics. Okay, they're mad. Okay, they say, they're talking Bible and all that. Do they ever know that if they open that word of God, their life would never be the same again? Okay. And many of those people have come in today in the faith and their lives have changed forever. And they said, how stupid we were. We were blinded. We didn't know that the word of God is so powerful. Our life would change forever because the Holy Spirit is so real. Okay. And that's why the word of God is living and powerful. So as he says, so when a soldier is in the presence of his enemies, he always eats, he clutches, he always will grab a quick snack, and he's not interested in the food, but he's always in a haste. Okay. So, but he still, God says, even in that situation, nothing is hurried. Okay. There's no confusion, no disturbance. The enemy is still at your door, but yes, God still prepares the table. Okay. And sits down and eats as if everything were in perfect peace. There was always conflict happening. Okay. He was talking about a spiritual enemy that's always there under attack. Okay. But that doesn't rob the joy of God in you. Okay. The table of grace is always there because the cups are never empty and it's always full. Okay. Come as you feel. There's a beautiful hymn, Russell. We should search that hymn. It's called The Table of Grace. So the table of grace is always full with everything. The cup will never run empty. It is always full. Okay. So when he says, my cup runneth over, despite the dangers about the presence of enemy, you know, though there are enemies all across, okay, he says he will anoint my head with oil, okay, and his cup will always be overfilled. Means you'll always have more than what you need in your life, okay. Now, what does oil refer to here?
The anointing.
Yes. Let me ask you one question here. If I ask you a question, how would it be if God had filled your cup in proportion to your faith? How much would you have in your cup?
Very little.
So he basically, remember one thing, and faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So we all need to open our Bibles and read every day, because the moment the word seeps in, our cup is getting full. Okay. And when God provides, I'll tell you, you will not even know. You'll be financially so blessed. You'll be not wondering how, you know, I'm blessed, because suddenly things start working in your life. You get a new business, new contract. Suddenly money comes in. It doesn't become important now because God is just providing it. Okay. You just seek him and he just provides. So it, and I want all of us on this group right now and everyone here to be financially blessed as well, because I know we need the money to survive, but God says, just seek me and trust me. Leave that to me. I will fill it for you. Imagine if our bank accounts are full and we just had, the Lord says, give, I will fill it up for you. And your cup will never run empty, because he says it will always run it over. Amen.
Amen.
That you'll always have more than okay, and so you will never have anything empty in our life, because God has promised us that if you give him everything, he will make your cup run it over. Remember how beautiful it is when you are blessed so much. You say money is not important. There are some people today I meet, they say God is everything for me today. I've gone through that phase. I have money, and those people are blessed because they give. And I always know if the person understands Luke 6:38 and starts giving, okay, and opens their purse, they will never lack in their life. In fact, they'll have so much, they'll always be ready to give. And God says, give, I will fill. Give, I will fill. And I say amen to that. Someone say amen to that. You will always have prosperity in your life. Amen.
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 All of us on this group will have prosperity, because Paul said amen.
Amen.
That's
amen.
The prosperity. That is the prosperity which God has given through his word. Okay. And we say amen to that, and God will deliver. Okay. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Okay. This is the last one. I just want quick sharing. What do you mean by mercy?
Forgiveness.
Yes. Do you know mercy is a covenant word? Mercy is a covenant word which says it is nothing but steadfast love forever. I will love you despite whatever you do. I will love you. God says, do whatever you want. I will still love you. Okay. He says, my mercy is unending. It will always be there. Now, what we need to do to come back?
A repentant heart.
Absolutely. Just that's the only thing we have to do. Just repent and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I did wrong. It was my pride, my ego that brought me here. I am sorry, Lord. Please restore me and let your mercy come on me. Because you have promised me, Lord, your mercy will fall on me. You will have pity on me. And do you know you're back again? Heaven's blessing is full and full flow on us. And God's favor rests on us. Do you know what's God's favor? Okay. God's favor is that whatever you do, Psalm 1:3. Can you read? Can you just open that quickly? Psalm 1:3. Russell, read, so that all of us are blessed. This is God's favor. His promise to us.
And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water.
Do we know if we are a tree planted by rivers of water, what happens to that tree if it has water all the time? Yeah, go ahead.
It will never die.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, Russell, go on.
that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither. And whatsoever he does shall prosper.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, amen to that. And everyone say amen to that.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You know what it says? Whatever I do will prosper. God will say, there are some people, whatever they do, it works for their good. Okay. I also want you to quickly open another amen, Romans 8:28, to everyone to say amen to this scripture as well. Because I want God's blessing on everyone who has attended this word session today. Because they had a choice. And God will bless, because if we give this time to him, he will bless us. So we need to say amen to this scripture as well. Romans 8:28.
And we know that all things work together.
Okay, again. In we know that all things, does it say some things?
All things.
Yes, all things work together.
For good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose.
I just quickly will share with you, if your life throws you a lemon, make a lemonade and tell the Lord, Lord, even if it's a lemon, you said you'll turn it for my good. Your word says that because I love you, God. And I know I'm called according to your purpose. And do you know what the Lord will say? He'll take that lime and make it into a lemonade. That'll be the best and the best situation of your life. I have gone through it. I have testimonies on that. Okay. And I will only say, I use this Romans 8:28. Please say amen to the scripture. Amen.
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 This is a very powerful scripture. Okay. Amen. I just want blessings over all of you today, because the word of God is so powerful, and God has told me everyone who is on this session is blessed. Okay. Because you all made time to understand his word. Russell, go. There's a last verse that we have. But you have to finish that. So mercy is a covenant word rendered steadfast love elsewhere. Okay. Together with goodness, it suggests the steady kindness and support that one can count in the family or from firm friends. We always have friends around. We can always have the goodness of God in our lives. Okay. So remember, we are always well escorted with a shepherd in front. Does the shepherd go behind or front, ahead of the sheep?
Ahead.
Ahead of the sheep.
Correct. Absolutely. You will not go behind. You normally, the head of the house will always go in the front, because he will, you know, be the head. And that's where Jesus is. He's ahead of us. We are behind him. Why should we worry? Because we know who is there ahead of us. He's the Lord. Okay. Amen. And we have the angels behind protecting us. So all the sides, there are angels. So we are like in a sheepfold where God has got his protection all around. There can be nothing that can happen. If God is for me, nothing can go against me. Is that a word of God? Amen.
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 And I will dwell in the house. Okay. Goodness and mercy shall follow me. Does it say some days of my life or all the days of my life?
All the days of my life.
So do you know one thing? Even if you make a mistake, please get back in the house and said, because the Lord says all the days of the life that my goodness and mercy will be on you. Okay. Goodness is nothing but God's favor on you. Okay. Unmerited, but God is having his special favor on you and your family, on everything you do. Whatever you do will prosper. Whatever you do will prosper, because that's God's favor on us. That's his grace. We never earned it. We didn't deserve it, but God has given it to us. That is called unmerited. Okay. So this is God's goodness on us. And we claim this in our life. And I'll tell you, today you'll see, from today onwards, I want you guys to see blessings in your life. And you say, wow, I did something in turn for my good. Whatever happened, it happened for my good. Because God will open different doors in our life and make us walk in. He's a God of results, not the God of I may or it may. Okay. If God has said it in his word, it's his will. And he says, if you pray according to my will, it's done. Because his word is his will. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Okay. So basically, the psalm basically ends by saying, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Do you know the day we all finish this, we just, you know, move from one door to the other door. Okay. Eternity is just a door away. Okay. Someone just, I had a very strong testimony of someone which I read about. You know, a person was dying, and the doctor was trying to, he was in the Lord. And he said, why are you worried about death? He says, no, I'm very scared to die. And he said, I just want to tell you one thing. There's a dog barking on the other side. Okay. and I'm in this door. I just want you to know one thing. When I open the door, what will the dog do? And that man just looked at him. When he opened the door, the dog just jumped in his arms. Okay. And that man who was dying, he said, it's the same way the Lord is waiting for you on the other side. Jump into his arms because he's already waiting for you. So at the end, it's not about anything. It's the Lord waking on the other side of the door. And it's a beautiful transition. It's not pain, but a beautiful ending to something great that you enjoyed on this earth. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. So when you eat and drink, there's a beautiful bond that is created, okay, during, you know, our loyalty. And it's basically the token of God's covenant to always provide for us. So to be God's guest is to be more than an acquaintance. Invite for a day to live with him forever. Okay. I'll just read something that was there. While I'm here, I will be a child at home with my God. The whole world shall be his house to me. And when I ascend into the upper chamber, okay, that's heaven, I shall not change my company, nor even change the house. I shall only go to dwell in the upper story of the house of the Lord forever and ever. Because he already dwells in me. It was just going up to the chamber and knowing he's there. Okay. So it was no change. He already, the moment you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that's when, you know, you're already seeing eternity. And our heaven has already started for all of us who accepted Christ as Lord and Savior. Amen.
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 I hope you like this teaching on this Psalm. And, you know, please share your testimonies. And, you know, hope you like this contemplative teaching session so that we can continue with your feedback. Russell, can you take us to the final hymn, please? Let's thank the Lord and sing. I'm sure we are muted, but please sing wherever you are and thank him today for this beautiful teaching so that we can apply it in our daily lives. I come before you today, and there's just one thing that I want to say.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Please leave
thank
your
you,
Vivek. Thank you, Vivek.
You're very beautiful.
So thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Russell.
Thank you, Russell. Thank you, Vivek.
Thank you, Vivek.
Thank you, and God bless.
Good night, and God bless.
Thank you, Vivek. Thank you, Russell.